There was a night of TV that was Mary Tyler Moore.
I watched the Mary Tyler Moore Show. There's not one show that I missed.
That show was big, big deal. Yeah.
It was second nature to me, so I didn't feel that separate from the character I was playing. You can take a
nothing day. She became America's sweetheart very quickly. Well, it's you, girl,
and you should know. I mean, she was gorgeous, and she had a sensuality about her.
She was an embracer of the world.
We became very close friends, and that's why it was such fun.
She just had a gift from God. And for me, she was a gift from God.
You get a jolt from the audience when they laugh at you.
She did everything so naturally and so gracefully. Is perfect
harmony. When she came on, it changed America.
It was a real turning point. The 70s were, and that show was.
I think Mary Tyler Moore has probably had more influence on my career than any other single person or force.
You're not allowed to ask that when someone's applying for a job. It's against the law.
Want to call a cop?
No.
It's a yardstick by which most sitcoms could not measure up to today.
You two would probably hit it off pretty good.
Well, I certainly wouldn't be averse to meeting Redford if the situation ever aroused. Rose.
She reaches right out through the television set, says, I gotcha.
Because who didn't love her? She was lovable. She was bright. She was gorgeous.
On the dance floor, everything was perfect for young Mary Tyler Moore. She could forget about her alcoholic mother, her distant father, the abuse by a family friend.
Because I wasn't a very happy little girl growing up.
When she was performing, all her problems melted away. This was the Mary the world would come to love. Focused. Fun-loving. The ideal daughter. The caring friend.
I was learning, I think, how much I loved it.
In her late teens, Mary was determined to make it as a dancer in Hollywood. No one spent more time perfecting her craft, ensuring her moves were flawless, her timing precise. These were skills that would serve Mary Tyler Moore well, but not on the dance floor.
I wanted to be a star dancer, but they weren't making that many musicals anymore.
Every day the holiday with Hot Boy.
I'm happy Hot Boy.
Mary turned to acting, and given her effortless beauty, small roles came fast.
77 Sunset Strip and Hawaiian Eye and, oh, Lord. But they did give me experience.
My mother was coming west to find a new home. My father had been killed during the Battle of Bull Run, fighting for the South.
But I thought you said before your father fought with the North.
Oh, well, he did. Both the North and the South. That way he didn't show any favoritism.
Small dramatic roles paid the rent, but Mary longed to do comedy. Then, sitcom star Danny Thomas auditioned her for a part as his daughter. Mary's breakthrough moment seemed at hand.
It started with hundreds of actresses, and it was pared down to just two of us, and I was one of them. And after the final audition, he came over to me and said, Mary, I want you to know that the reason you didn't get the job is not because you're not a good actress. It's because you have a very funny nose, and no one would believe you're my daughter.
It may have been Penny Parker who got the role, but it was Mary Tyler Moore whose career was about to explode.
Here, Rich, this is it. This is Daddy's office. See the typewriter? That's where Daddy writes the show.
In 1959, Carl Reiner produced a pilot for a TV show. He cast himself as the star, playing a comedy writer named Rob Petrie.
Hey, what gives, Rob? What's with the kid?
He can't function with a child.
Please, as a personal favor, let him stay here. He has no idea how his father earns a living.
And you want him to find out?
The network loved the show, but it hated the idea of Carl Reiner in the lead.
And the network said, Carl, you're wrong with the part. But he wrote for himself.
The entire cast was fired. Reiner hired Dick Van Dyke for the lead role, but he couldn't find the right actress to play Van Dyke's wife. Until Mary Tyler Moore walked in the door.
I gave her a page to read, and she said the first line, and I heard the sound in her voice, a ping in her voice.
And Carl Reiner just looked at me with a kind of a look of awe.
Soon as she read that line, my hand became the claw in that machine that picks out candy in the at the arcades. I walked across the room.
In the middle of the scene, he put his hand on my head, sitting in a chair across from him, and said, get up. I got up, and he steered me down the hall to Sheldon Leonard's office.
And I walked down the hall to Sheldon Leonard's, and I said, Sheldon, I got her. And that was it.
And we read the scene again, and I knew that something wonderful was happening.
Morning, honey.
What do you mean by that? It may be a good morning for you, but it wasn't for me. You didn't have to clean up the mess that this one made when he decided to finger paint all over the bathroom mirror with the toothpaste. And you don't have to be concerned at all about the fact that the cleaning woman isn't coming today and you have five people coming for lunch. Sure, go ahead. Good morning. Why not?
Honey, give me another chance.
Carl Reiner packed the cast with experienced comedy pros like Rose Marie, Maury Amsterdam, and Richard Deacon. It might have been an intimidating environment for a newcomer like Mary, but Reiner knew just how to nurture the budding actress.
He became, to me, my father, my confessor, my best friend, my brother. He was everything that a woman would like to have around her to make her feel strong and appreciated.
I was those things to her, and she needed those things. Her father was a man who never said a word to her.
Reiner brought Mary along gradually, building her confidence by letting her do what she knew best, dance. Soon, Carl Reiner gave Mary small physical bits to build her comic skills.
We only could do it one time because we only had one inflatable boat. We never practiced. Whatever happens on the show is what we use. That's good acting, using the moment and being yourself.
She just got it so quickly that I'm still fascinated by how fast she grew on that show.
A key step came when Carl Reiner gave Mary a chance to cry funny. Always the student, Mary went to everyone she could for advice.
It's got to be a funny cry. She says, how do you cry funny? And she said, I really don't know how to cry at all. She said, show me.
I got to go to pieces in front of him and tell him what madness drove me to this act and how sorry I was and how stupid I was, but he did seem to not be giving me very much attention and so on, and I got to cry.
And the gray hair! And the purple mind! And the general yuckiness!
I prepared very well for that crying scene. I copied everything that Nanette Fabre ever did in a crying scene. and she was the master.
Nanette, I'm terribly sorry. Nanette, I didn't mean to make you cry, really. I'm sorry.
Take your hands off me, Philip Pendleton.
Years later, Mary and Nanette would have a chance to shed some tears together. A rare moment for television's two best criers.
Well, if I knew you felt so strongly about it, I wouldn't have brought the meatloaf.
Mother, we are not talking about the meatloaf.
Well, then what are we talking about?
Bridget, Mom, will you stop crying? That isn't fair.
I'm not crying.
On the Dick Van Dyke Show, Mary's repertoire of vulnerability grew quickly. Embarrassment became her comic trademark.
What'd you win?
Oh, I won a dryer and a rotis. And I'm so unhappy.
The one where she blabs that Carl wears a toupee was the tour de force.
Oh, he got you to say something embarrassing, didn't he?
That Alan Brady is bald.
The scene with Carl, where he's got all of his toupees up there. You remember he calls Mary in, and he said, there she is, fellas.
Fellas? There she is. There's the little lady who puts you out of business.
As you know, Alan, I... You see, when I... Well, it...
What?
How's your foot?
How does it look?
And as I put my leg down, I hit it on the phone accidentally.
Ooh.
And I went, and I screamed into the phone. I loved that when I saw that.
You can ask anybody. I have always said that I like you so much better without your,
It's hair! You didn't have any trouble saying it on television.
I said to her, boy, that was perfect.
For Mary Tyler Moore, developing her comedy skills did not mean losing her femininity. She was blazing a trail for a new generation of women on television.
That's right. One of the few who maintained her femininity. I mean, she was gorgeous and she had a sensuality about her, and she always kept it.
Mary's beauty and comic timing mixed perfectly with her self-effacing persona. The result? She possessed a unique ability to connect with viewers. The whole country wanted to give her a hug.
She was there, Mary. And that's a wonderful quality for any performer to get from an audience. They're wanting to take care of you because they love you. Isn't that wonderful? That's a gift. That's a gift.
Mary's mannered persona was in stark contrast to the outsized antics of the most popular female comedian of the 1960s.
Do you think we could squeeze out through the car? We might not have to. In a few minutes, we'll be able to float out.
She is a brilliant clown. She creates her own comedy. I'm an actress who can perform comedy well, but I am not a comedian. They're two very different things.
Lucille Ball's sitcom filmed on the stage next door to the Dick Van Dyke Show. Often the veteran would secretly watch the rookie at work.
She would apparently come over to our soundstage and climb up the ladder on the wall and walk her way over the catwalk. And one day, I guess we had done something that really got to her, and she laughed out loud. I mean, there was no missing that laugh. And we looked at her, and she came down, and she was talking to all of us. And as she was leaving, she turned around to me, and she said, "You're very good." Not a lot of flowers, not a lot of comedy in that, but it really hit me. And I knew that I must have something worth continuing with.
Mary's growing skills on The Dick Van Dyke Show opened up the opportunity to guest star on variety shows of the era. Most notably, a special with Danny Kaye. Five years on The Dick Van Dyke Show meant Mary had the opportunity to learn from one of TV's most talented comedians.
When I cast Mary, I brought her in to meet Dick, and Dick took me aside and he said, hey, she's beautiful and lovely, but he says, she's much too young. Nobody's going to believe it. That, you know, he said, he was 31 and she was like 23. And I said, believe me, they'll believe it.
11 years her senior and vastly more experienced, Van Dyke took the time to help Mary learn the ropes.
He's a great human being and one of the most generous performers that I've ever worked with.
She was 23 when she came on the show and had never done any comedy.
He was back there giving me little hints, little helpful suggestions and things.
She did some takes that I said, now you're on the right track.
Why didn't you call me?
Because I thought you might be in conference with Miss Blake.
Oh, come on now, Lori. Since when have I ever been too busy to talk to you?
You've been very busy, Blakely.
I mean, it's wonderful to help someone else get a laugh, but it's God's own gift to get one yourself.
I always wondered if I could get back into shape enough so that someone would offer me a job as a professional dancer again. And now I know. I did it. And I wondered if I could take the strain of the daily classes and the rehearsals and the exercise. And now I know, I can't.
You can't?
No, Rob. There isn't a bone in my body that isn't screaming, for heaven's sake, lie down in a hot tub.
After The Dick Van Dyke Show ended in 1966, Mary was cast alongside Julie Andrews in Thoroughly Modern Millie.
Oh, but, my bags. Oh, it's all right. We can manage. I live here. Oh, thank you.
It was the kind of film Mary had long dreamed of performing in. A chance to sing and dance in a movie musical.
She's the girl next door. And she's also a looker. And look, she can dance. Oh, my God, this is a great package.
I must study you if I'm going to be an actress. You see, the theater today is full of ruthless women.
Art reflects life. That was in a speed test. But it's true, women today are free. For the first time, we're man's equal. We can go out into the world and make a life for ourselves. And I fully intend to.
So do I.
2 years later, Mary landed a starring role in Change of Habit. But when Elvis Presley signed on, Mary's role was diminished.
John, please.
You gotta be kidding.
I'm a member of the Order of the Little Sisters of Mary. John, please say something.
I'd be damned.
I'm sorry.
Mary Tyler Moore was Elvis Presley's last leading lady in his final dramatic film.
Let me show you how to do this. Put these three fingers right here, honey. Like that. Go ahead. That's right. Now this one right here. Very good. Now these three here.
What?
These three right here.
It wasn't only Elvis's swan song. Mary Tyler Moore also gave up on films for more than a decade. Instead, she tried Broadway in a lavish musical based on Breakfast at Tiffany's. The play failed miserably. By the late 1960s, Mary's career was foundering.
I even went to a psychologist long after the show went off the air, just to see what I might have done as a career had I not chosen to be a performer. And it was 3 days of testing. And at the end of it, the result was that in mathematics, I function at about a fourth grade level, just not there. And that I would be best suited for work either as a model or a member of the armed forces.
Mary Tyler Moore didn't need to enlist. All she needed was a nudge from her old friend, Dick Van Dyke.
He did a variety special, asked me to be on it with him, and he just gave me the spotlight.
Are you all right?
Huh?
Are you all right?
Yeah, you had me going. Oh, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
Did walnuts come out of that closet?
Walnuts?
Yeah.
We showcased her. She danced, we did sketches and network saw that and gave her a series right away.
Hey, I got another remember when.
What?
Remember when I said I'd like you to come on my special?
Mm-hmm.
And you said how long was it? And I said an hour?
Yeah.
What's up?
And it was from that special that CBS decided to ask me to do my own series. All thanks to Dick.
Starting in 1970, The Mary Tyler Moore Show began an unprecedented run, winning more acting Emmy Awards than any show in TV history, including 4 for Mary, 3 for both Valerie Harper and Ed Asner, and 2 each for Betty White, Cloris Leachman, and Ted Knight.
Is this a picture of you with Nikita Khrushchev?
Yeah.
What?
Oh, don't touch that!
You pasted your face on somebody else's body?
The structure of the series put Mary at the stable center in a universe of quirky characters.
She straighted for all of us. She was the straight man so much of the time.
You have to wash a pot that you just boiled water in. How should I know? I only use paper pots.
I kind of liked Murray. He's a brown bagger I could kind of associate with.
Ted has this really silly idea that you're carrying on with some cheap floozy.
And you promised you wouldn't tell, darling.
Phyllis, when I first read the script, said was neurotic.
I have to go to the hairdressers.
Don't you have to be at the office? How can you have your hair done?
Mary, it's for those patients I'm doing this. I feel if I look my best, it gives them hope. Something to shoot for.
Eventually, it turned out, I think, that I was the sure, firm touch on the wrong note. Confident. Proud of all the things that you shouldn't be proud of.
Did you know the male bee is nothing but the slave of the queen? And once the male bee, has serviced the queen, the male dies. All in all, not a bad system.
Lou Grant gave me my center.
You want to go out on a date with me? You're out of your mind.
He's a simpler soul. He's a more honest soul, far less devious than I am.
We're friends. We respect each other. We care for each other. We care a great deal. How can two people who feel like that date each other?
Perhaps the most eccentric of all the characters on the show was anchorman Ted Baxter, played by Ted Knight.
The Chamber of Commerce announces they are beginning to take applications for the Queen of the Winter Carnival. So all you pink-nosed little snow bunnies... Mary, can you see I'm doing the news? Read it. All right.
His posture, and then his delivery. He was just fabulous.
Ted, you're not getting a Teddy Award. You weren't nominated this year. I'm sorry, but there will be other years.
To Despite all the comic talent, in the first few weeks of the series, ratings were poor. Critics called it a disaster and labeled Mary's character a spinster.
Just trying to do the best show we could, getting to know each other, becoming familiar with the role, praying that it lasted.
Within a few weeks, the show found its footing and soon became a Saturday night institution.
There was a night of TV that was Mary Tyler Moore.
I watched the Mary Tyler Moore show. There's not one show that I missed.
That show was big, big deal, yeah.
Every Saturday night, for as long as that series was on the air.
Behind the scenes, the atmosphere at the Mary Tyler Moore show was more friendly than the average sitcom, thanks largely to Mary's tireless efforts to ensure a happy set.
Generosity. She would say, in a run-through, you know, Jim, Alan, I think this joke is a rota line. I don't think it's as good for Mary. She's giving away laughs.
If everyone is getting along, they're obviously doing their best work. I don't care whether you're a mechanic in a garage or an executive high above Park Avenue, you know. If you like each other, you work with each other, and it can't help but make the product good.
The show is just full of love. It's that basic. It's love. It's love. Mary Tyler Moore's thing was love is all around.
Valerie Harper and Cloris Leachman were especially close. Their off-screen friendship enhanced the comedy.
We loved each other. We were great friends. We'd go to lunch every day and decide what we were going to do.
I always had fun with Cloris in a scene.
Mary, you're not doing her any favors, encouraging her in this life of sloth. Oh, come on, Phyllis, she's not slothy.
The show where Valerie has lost her job as a window dresser, and she's in Mary's apartment day and night, night and day, 24/7. I'm just sick of it. I'm just sick of it.
Mary, as her friends, we owe it to her to straighten her out. We have to force her to take a good, hard look at herself. We have to shake her up. We have to slap some sense into her.
And she says, Rhoda.
Rhoda!
And then she says it a second time with a lot of power. Rhoda!
Rhoda!
And then she comes over and takes and disconnects my dryer. And that was an old time. I don't think they even make them anymore.
Rhoda!
The show is brilliant because Mary is who you want to be, who you wish you were. Rhoda is who you probably are, and Phyllis is who you're afraid you'll become. And that's pretty close to the truth.
Actors especially liked working on the series because the writing was superior to most other sitcoms of the era.
Nobody ever had to complain or suggest that something be changed because the scripts were always near perfect when we got them. We would sit around the table on Monday morning and they would come down near perfect.
You value that writing. You never take it for granted because it doesn't happen that often.
At the helm were James L. Brooks and Alan Burns. Their goal was to create comedy that flowed from real characters, not the cardboard cutouts that so often populate sitcoms.
Television has a responsibility.
Get it, Mayor?
Will you shut up, Ted?
I knew they respected the truth, and I knew they weren't ever going to make a joke that didn't make sense. It was going to be because it followed.
This was such an important night to Wes. He was counting on it so much. And I don't have a handkerchief.
The biggest cultural breakthrough on the show was the portrayal of Mary herself, the first single independent career woman on television.
Working here for 3 years and doing every little piddly job from ordering paper clips to tweezers, I think I am ready for a little more responsibility. Something challenging, something difficult.
You do, huh?
Yes, I do. And I think if you did that for me, it would take some of the load off your shoulders.
You're right. You're
right. In an era when women were fighting for equal rights, Mary Tyler Moore was the most visible example of a new future for women.
When she came on, it changed America. So many women have told me it changed their lives, made it possible for them to work themselves.
When you see somebody accomplishing something that your heart also desires, and you see them do it so well, the message of that is possible.
I've got some responsibility for you right now. Two things, as a matter of fact.
You do? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's great. Great.
First thing, I want you to hire a new sportscaster.
Ah, oh, Mr. Grant, thank you. That's wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't know that Ed is leaving.
And neither does he. That's the second thing you'd do. Fire Ed.
Mr. Grant, please, no. I've never fired anybody in my life. I met a cleaning lady once I couldn't fire, so I moved.
Mary's character wasn't militant. She made her point in a quiet, endearing way that fit Mary's natural personality.
There was a goodness about her and a kindness about her that I related to in myself, and, oh, my God, I wanted to be mayor.
She never would, like, blow up or something. She would say, well, that wasn't a very nice thing to say.
Because if you push me, then I just might have to push back. Hard. Come on, you can't carry that off. I know.
I was kind of that woman. You know, I was that person. I grew up in a very conservative household, and I went to a private girls' school, and you behaved in a certain way, and it was second nature to me. So I didn't feel that separate from the character I was playing.
I was playing a very mean character. It was a hospital scene where she was having her tonsils out, and I was a very crusty lady. And I took Mary on, and I dished it out to her. I was horrible to her.
So how come you changed rooms?
Because of my roommate.
Your roommate?
Yeah, she kept wanting to talk.
I got hate mail from that show. I received hate. How dare you treat our Mary in that manner? I want to say, folks, I'm paid to say those words. I think Mary is wonderful. I'm with you.
Feminist leaders like Gloria Steinem were not happy with Mary's subtle portrayal and wanted her to play a leading role in the emerging feminist movement.
I believed that women, and still do, have a very major role to play as mothers. It's very necessary for mothers to be involved with their children. And that's not what Gloria Steinem was saying. Gloria was saying, oh, you can do everything. And you owe it to yourself to have a career. And I didn't really believe in that.
The Mary Tyler Moore Show did comment on the moral issues of the early 70s, but subtly and with humor.
The several episodes that I was involved with Sherry North, who was a band singer, and there's a wonderful moment in the office where, you know, I get worried about what kind of reputation she might have.
Okay, so there have been some other men.
Not some other men, lots of other men.
Well, what's the cutoff point, Mr. Grant? I mean, is there some number? You know, I'd really like to know. How many men is a woman allowed to have before she becomes that sort of woman?
Six.
Walks out.
I wash my hands of the entire matter.
There's a beat. She comes back in and looks at me incredulously and says,
six?
In the same way, when the show's producers took on racial issues, the storylines flowed naturally from the characters.
The producers, Alan Burns and Jim Brooks, they were such class acts, they didn't pander to the lowest common denominator. They did not go for the obvious race jokes that every other writer in the business seemed to be going for.
Is that what you think, that I'm not good enough? I mean, go ahead, say it if it's true. Don't worry, I'm man enough to take it.
Okay, Ted, maybe that's the reason. Maybe I don't think you're good enough.
Ha ha ha!
Gordy was contrary to most of the roles that were being given to African-American actors at the time, and that he wasn't a stereotype.
You know, Ted, when I told you before that my life is the same as yours, I was lying. It's better. Want to hear the terms of my contract, Ted?
No.
Yeah.
I don't
want to. I got a penthouse in E60s.
Oh.
And a company pays for it. That's right, Ted. You know I get to work every day? Chauffeured limo to and from. Chauffeured limo, Ted. That's right. And my picture hangs right next to Walter Cronkite. Oh.
Backstage, the series stayed true to its values, hiring more female writers than any other sitcom of the era.
Bridesmaid dresses. Who thinks of that? What man thinks of a bridesmaid's dress? Every woman, if you ask her, she will get into a horrible, not flattering outfit for her girlfriend.
Well, come on out, kid. How bad could it be?
There's one, we're in little Bo Peep costumes. That's what they look like. Literally.
Who would have thought that the stuff I said was packed around the dress was the dress?
Just to have more women writing and that women can be funny.
The Mary Tyler Moore Show's most acclaimed episode involved the death of Chuckles the Clown.
Well, what happened, Lou? Who died, would you tell us?
Chuckles. Chuckles the Clown is dead. It was a freak accident. He went to the parade dressed as Peter Peanut. And a rogue elephant tried to shell him.
On paper, the Chuckles episode ran 5 minutes short. But once the story was performed for a live audience, the show came out the right length, thanks to laughter.
So I went out there where the first scene was with Murray. And he starts telling one-liners about, you know, born in a trunk, died in a trunk.
Lucky more people weren't hurt. Lucky that elephant didn't go after somebody else.
That's right. After all, you know how hard it is to stop after just one peanut.
Because it's so hard to stop after one peanut. That's when the house went up like that.
And with each one, I laughed belly laughs like I'd never laughed on camera before.
That's not funny, Murray.
And it infected the audience. And we added a minute in that scene. And that same process just kept going, adding minutes throughout the show.
Remember how when his arch rival, Senor Kaboom... hit him with a giant cucumber and knocked him down. Mr. Fee-Fi-Fo would always pick himself up. Dust himself off and say, I hurt my poo-poo.
She had to do that twice. You only see it once, but she did it twice. Whew. It was as good the second time as the first time, and it's technique.
And what did Chuckles ask in return? Not much. In his own words, a little song, a little seltzer, Donnie.
By the end of the performance, we had amassed our missing 5 minutes.
Given the acting talent on the show, it's not surprising that nearly every performer got their own series. Some even before the Mary Tyler Moore Show went off the air. The first was Valerie Harper's Rhoda.
People fell in love with Rhoda. Everybody knew A. Rhoda Morgenstern. Say, I recognize her. Gee, that's like my niece. Does she run the drugstore down the block?
As great characters were spun off, others filled their shoes. The departing Cloris Leachman and Valerie Harper meant the entrance of Betty White.
One Saturday morning, I remember the phone rang and it was Mary. She said, "But hey, would you do a guest shot on my show?" Well, of course, she had to coax, as you can imagine.
I think what we have to talk about is more important than your chocolate souffle.
I'm sorry, but this is a very critical time.
Well, I'm sorry. This is a very critical time for me, too.
Oh, my poor baby.
Sue Ann Nivens was the happy homemaker. She also had a little problem that she liked men. Any men, anybody's men. She just liked men.
Doug is from Saskatchewan. He was on my show last week when I was demonstrating how to cook without a kitchen.
And that was sort of what made the character kind of fun.
Eventually, Sue Ann's bedroom was revealed in one of the series' funniest episodes.
Haven't you ever seen my bedroom before, ma'am?
No, I would have remembered this.
They discovered that she had this, like a triple king-size bed.
The idea of the audience being privy to her bedroom after all this talk about her wildness.
How have you been, Ted?
Oh, swell, Sue Ann. What a great bedroom, Sue Ann.
All of a sudden, Ted is there straightening his tie in the ceiling. So you know the whole thing is mirrored up there. It was funny.
I really feel terrible if I did anything to make you leave the station.
I used to go to motel rooms, my wife and I, and spend 25 cents to get a vibrating bed. And now they did, that's the genius of the writers.
By 1977, the show's writer-producers wanted to end the series, but Mary did not. Eventually, she decided to give in and move on.
Jim and Alan were anxious to write for somebody other than a young woman living in Minneapolis. And so they did Taxi. The other actors, I think, wanted to go on and try new things. I was still just having a marvelous time and didn't really want to do it. But good things happened to me and probably wouldn't have had we gone on with the show for very much longer.
And last night I thought, what is a family anyway? They're just people who make you feel less alone and really loved. And that's what you've done for me.
In the series' final episode, Mary Richards says goodbye to her colleagues at WJM in TV's most famous group hug.
I treasure you people.
Final scene, all in the office, and we're all hugging, and the Kleenex was there, and they were sitting out, and how do we get the Kleenex? And Jim Brooks said, go for it, and that's when that whole thing started.
I think we all need some Kleenex.
There's some on Mary's desk.
We're always loving and leaving.
When she turned on the lights for the last time, it was the end of that show, but a new beginning for a lot of us, because you have to go on.
Mary, and my heart's right there. It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary. sweetest girl I know. Goodbye, Cricket Dinnerly.
The end of her sitcom created an opportunity for Mary to follow her longtime dream of a weekly variety show.
So, variety. Okay, let's give it a try.
Variety was wonderful for me because it answered my singing and dancing drive.
Once again, Mary surrounded herself with gifted performers.
This year, I'm going to be surrounded by a fantastic bunch of people who'll be with me every week. And I'd like you to meet them in the same way I did, through their audition tapes.
We had the just burgeoning David Letterman.
David Letterman, audition tape!
Hi, Mary. My name's Dave Letterman.
We had Michael Keaton.
I'll tell you what. I just go home and I wait for your call, okay? I gotta get going because I gotta do some dental work on my cat. So just leave a message.
Just a brilliant bunch of people. And we did some very well-written and singular sketches. But it didn't catch on. Just didn't work.
Mary tried a second variety show the next year, but the results were the same. As the 1970s came to a close, Mary Tyler Moore's future was unclear. Her new television projects had not found an audience. She battled alcoholism. Her marriage to TV executive Grant Tinker was headed for divorce. And then the worst blow of all, her only son died in an accident in 1980.
It was a tragedy, a terrible tragedy. She's had so many tragedies. And it's just very sad.
At a time when many might have slid into despair, Mary Tyler Moore found a way out. In fact, her comeback was already underway. When Robert Redford read the best-selling book Ordinary People, he knew it would be the perfect story for his debut as a director. In the role of the uptight, repressive Beth Jarrett, Redford chose Mary Tyler Moore. To many, the choice seemed all wrong. But Robert Redford knew exactly what he was doing.
You drink too much at parties, Calvin.
I'm not drunk.
Why did you tell Annie Marshall that Conrad is seeing a psychiatrist?
I don't know. Why not?
Well, for one thing, I don't think people hear that kind of thing very easily.
Come on. For most people, it's a status symbol right up there with going to ear.
Well, I thought your blurting it out like that was in very bad taste.
I didn't think
not
it was
Not to
in
mention
bad
a violation
taste.
Of privacy.
Whose privacy?
Our privacy. The family's privacy. I think it is a very private matter.
I like working for a director. I like being shaped and encouraged and discouraged.
I know I'm not perfect. And if I can't go around hugging everybody all the time the way you do, then I'm sorry.
I'm not asking you to be perfect. You're missing the point.
I don't want to see any doctors or counselors. I'm me. This is my family. And if we have problems, then we will solve those problems in the privacy of our own home, not by running to some kind of specialist every time something goes wrong.
Are you folks ready to order?
Fans and movie critics alike were stunned by Mary Tyler Moore's moving performance. And she was nominated for an Oscar.
We just want you to be happy.
Happy?
Yes.
Ward, you tell me the definition of happy, huh? But first you better make sure that your kids are good and safe. That no one's fallen off a horse or been hit by a car or drowned in that swimming pool you're so proud of.
Oh.
And then you come to me and tell me how to be happy.
Oh, she put you away. Her character just put you away.
It also gave her a chance to show the other side of this comedian. And I thought she was magnificent in it.
The film won Best Picture for Robert Redford, and Timothy Hutton won Best Supporting Actor. Both owe a major debt to Mary Tyler Moore.
You remember Buck asked you, he tried to talk you into getting a dog? Do you remember that? And he said, how about if it's just the size of a little football?
You know, that animal next door, that Pepper or Pippin, whatever
Pippin,
his name
Pippin,
is.
Pippin, Pippin.
He's not a very friendly dog. I don't care what Mr. McGreary says.
What he really wanted
really
was
not.
The retriever that was down the street for
and
sale.
And every time
that's
that dog
wanted,
comes into this backyard and I try to get him out, put that on if you're going to stay out here, okay?
It was heart-wrenching. But at that time, for Mary to go from what she'd been doing and what the audience thought of her to this really suffering.
That same year, Mary returned to Broadway in Whose Life Is It Anyway? This time earning critical praise and a Tony Award. At about the same time, she met the man who would become her third and final husband, Dr. Robert Levine, forming, by all accounts, her happiest marriage. Mary Tyler Moore continued to act, but now her life was entering a new chapter, with a special focus on helping others, including a major effort to raise awareness of type 1 diabetes, a lifelong condition for Mary.
But that's the passion I have to this moment.
2 years ago, I joined the 100-child delegation to...
She testified before Congress, served as president of the Juvenile Diabetes Association, and even wrote a book to help others cope with the disease.
If type 1 is not diagnosed quickly enough or left untreated, you die.
Despite all her work for good causes, Mary's greatest legacy is as a role model, inspiring women from all walks of life.
She was a role model for me, not just in, oh, gee, I see Mary on TV and I really like Mary, but wow, what kind of woman and what kind of businesswoman created this?
Thank you, Mary, for being such an inspiration to us all of us women in television.
Mary Tyler Moore herself walked out and surprised me on that show. It's still one of the greatest, most profound surprises. It was the first time I actually ever ugly cried, like snot running out of your nose cried. That opening scene, who can turn the world on with her smile?
This is one of the favorite, most fun things I've ever done. I cannot watch this enough.
For that moment, it was suspended reality for me. Who can turn the world on with her smile? Mary Tyler Moore lived in Minneapolis. I tried for years to get a job in Minneapolis. I wanted to move to Minneapolis. I wanted to be in Minneapolis because of Mary Tyler Moore. That one moment where I throw my hat up in the air. Oh my goodness, I dreamed of that moment forever.
Tossing the hat was a symbolic moment, an expression of freedom and new beginnings. Like no one else in the 1970s, Mary Tyler Moore embodied that idea, and a generation looked to follow her lead.
Your legacy is every life that you touched.
You're going to make it on your own was her theme song. But that's the paradox of Mary Tyler Moore. Because she wasn't alone at all. She was surrounded by people who loved her. Millions all across the world.
Because who didn't love her? She was lovable. She was bright. She was gorgeous.
She's the girl next door. And she's also a looker. And look, she can dance. Oh, my God, this is a great package.
All of a sudden, there's one that kind of knocks your socks off. And she's one of those.
The combination of everything that she's ever done in her life that touched our hearts, that made us want to turn the world on with our own smiles.
Somebody said, were you jealous of Mary? I said, next to her family, I was probably the most proud person in the world.
Mary Tyler Moore remained the perfectly beautiful icon. She's the Grace Kelly of comedians.
A national treasure. Mary is a national treasure.
And I fancied myself a young Katharine Hepburn about the time that we started the Dick Van Dyke Show. And if in a rerun you watched the right episode, you'll catch me up on saying things like, "Oh, darling."
For more insider features about your favorite TV stars, visit pbs.org. To order this program, visit us online at shoppbs.org or call us at 1-800-PLAY-PBS.